And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no. No, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the
Captain Carl did it all this past season, but the final curtain is still in the future. In 77, he passed such names as Ruth, Gary, Williams, Fox, DiMaggio, and Cronin on baseball's all-time list of personal accomplishments. And in 78, he has dead aim on such Hall of Famers as Mays, Mantle, Clemente, and Hornsby. At 38, an age when most players have long since departed, Yaz keeps rolling on. Manager Don Zimmer was so right. The Red Sox captivated New England fans at the start and kept them all the way. In the smallest ballpark in baseball, the Red Sox attracted an average of more than 28,000 fans per game, almost 85% of Fenway's capacity. Home run records, brilliant late-inning relief pitching, 97 victories, a mere two games behind the eventual world champions. It was truly a team effort, spurred on by the greatest baseball fans in the world. The 1977 Boston Red Sox, a team to be remembered. More than 2.3 million fans jammed Fenway Park during the 1978 season, and the New England faithful saw it all. Richly earned success and frantic frustration. They saw a team soar to a 10-game lead early, then slump because of a rash of injuries and misfortune, and then stage a stretch comeback which became the talk of the baseball world. The Boston Red Sox battled the opposition in many ways, with their gloves in their arms. They were daring on the base paths, which made for winning baseball, the stuff pennant dreams are built on. The Red Sox batters rolled up a season's 172 team homers and had a .267 club batting average. These Fenway sluggers raised havoc at the plate, making contact, it seemed, with everything the rival pitchers threw up there. Len Barker of the Texas Rangers found a unique way to escape the big bats of the Red Sox. The Red Sox had 13 new players on the 78 team, unusual for a club which had finished a close second the year before. Dennis Eckersley came over from Cleveland with a style and talent which made him a 20-game winner. The Eck had an 11-1 record in Fenway Park and beat the Yankees four times. Mike Torres bolstered the pitching staff by winning 16 games in his first year with the Sox. And finally, there was Jerry Remy, whose play at second base stabilized the Red Sox time and again. With first place at stake, the Red Sox took on the young, challenging Detroit Tigers at Fenway Park late in May. When it was over, the Red Sox had taken all four games, and Jim Rice was just beginning to show his talent. Three to score. Red Sox tied it on Fred Lynn's infield hit in the eighth inning to Thompson.
And there's a line shot left field. Looking up, this ball is gone, a home run. And look at the Red Sox greet Jimmy Rice at home plate.
In their first West Coast trip in early June, the Sox took two out of three from the Angels and swept Seattle to start a season's high nine-game winning streak. Fred Lynn joined a long ball act to win the second game in Anaheim. And in the event there is any doubt at all about Fred Lynn's all-around talent, watch this catch back in Fenway. Red Sox didn't meet the Yankees until mid-June, and the managers Don Zimmer and Billy Martin reflected the tenseness surrounding this confrontation. Thurman Munson hit a home run to give the Yankees an early 4-1 lead, but the Red Sox, who dominated the Yankees in the early going, fought back. The Red Sox bats came alive against the Yankees star relief pitcher Goose Gossage, and the Red Sox dugout loved every second. The final outcome, the Red Sox 10, the Yankees 4. In Game 3, Dennis Eckersley gave up only two New York runs while the Red Sox bats exploded. Senator Billy Martin lifted his starting pitcher, Jim Beattie, in favor of Dick Kidrow, and Butch Hobson took him deep. Jim Catfish Hunter followed, and he couldn't stop the Red Sox either. It had to be Hunter's low point of the year. Dennis Eckersley finally beat the Yankees for the first time in his career. Red Sox 9, Yankees 2, and the Sox had taken 2 out of 3 from the defending world champion. The high-riding Baltimore Orioles came to town, and the Red Sox kept rolling along, with daring and hustle exemplified by foul ball plays by Pudge Fisk and Butch Hobson.
Here's the 2-1 pitch. He jammed him in a little pop fly. Hobson, near the dugout, has it, and falls into the runway. Is he all right? That's the first thing we want to find out, is Singleton and Ralph Salvon, the trainer, and now Don Zimmer and Charlie Moss come running over. He made the catch and comes out of the runway. What a play by Butch Hobson.
Hobson escaped what might have been a serious injury, but it might have been a bit prophetic as far as things to come. The injury jinx, which eventually would cost the Red Sox the pennant, finally made its presence felt. In the next series in Baltimore, Butch Hobson suffered the first of many key injuries. Over the entire season, the Red Sox team had 32 separate injuries. In fact, there were only 37 times when manager Don Zimmer was able to field his best team. But what may have been the most costly injury of all happened to shortstop Rick Burleson. Just 2 days before the All-Star game for which he had been selected, Burleson suffered a badly sprained left ankle and was out for 17 games. That the Red Sox started to slip thereafter is more than mere coincidence. Rick's fine range and sure hands, his tremendous instinct for all phases of playing shortstop, the gun which is his throwing arm, and his ever-present alertness and ability to react to the unusual. It isn't hard to estimate what the loss of Rick Burleson for that extended period meant to the Red Sox cause. Then there was Carl Yastrzemski, the 39-year-old Red Sox captain who played much of the season with both wrists taped. But Yaz, nonetheless, continued to be the inspirational force which has marked much of his 18 years in a Red Sox uniform. He swung the bat with the same old power. And at first base, Yaz cavorted like a youngster. And nobody could play left field in Fenway like Carl.
We talk about leading by example, and the captain, Carl Yastrzemski, 39 years old, playing in left center field on a ball that seemed to be a certain extra base hit and would have been a run because Munson was going. Watch Carl take off and into the teeth of the wind, racing, and one play he could make, and that was the backhanded play, extending himself against the wall, quickly got the ball back, and Munson, as mazed as everyone in this ballpark, was doubled off, and another big defensive play for the Red Sox.
Following the All-Star break, the Red Sox hit the road. After opening up a 10-game lead early in July, the Sox went into a bad batting slump, and their lead was shaved to 5 games at the end of the month. In Kansas City, manager Don Zimmer's club was hurt time and again by some great base running. And the Sox were beaten in Texas by some fine catches like this one by Al Oliver. In Boston, Royals shortstop Fred Patek couldn't handle Fred Lynn's hard grounder that scored the game's only run. And Carlton Fisk gunned down stolen base artist Willie Wilson in the ninth inning.
Wilson goes, and the pitch is taken for a ball. The throw to second base, and they've got it!
And rookie Jim Wright, who would win 8 games during the season, walked away with his third shutout in a 1-0 victory. The Red Sox had only a 4.5-game lead over Milwaukee when they went to Yankee Stadium for two games in early August. The Yankees jumped into a quick 5-0 lead, but the Red Sox came back and finally cut it to 5-4 as Rich Gossage had control troubles and walked Yaz and Jack Brohammer. Then in the seventh, with runners on second and third, Bill Campbell, who pitched 5 1/3 innings of great relief, fanned Reggie Jackson to kill off a big threat. The Red Sox tied it, but it took some time because of the first of two rain delays. Jim Rice doubled, and after the first rain delay, he scored on Yastrzemski's sacrifice fly.
Yaz hits it in the air, deep to right center field, and Rice will score easily. And the game will be tied, and Yastrzemski drives in his second run of the game. It's 5-5, and what a comeback for the Red Sox, who found themselves trailing 5-0 in the first three innings.